Economics correspondent Paul Solman spends a lot of time trying to explain and assess why markets, individuals, consumers, and businesses behave the way they do. But there's a growing school of thought that says the traditional answers to those questions may not be the correct ones. Paul caught up with one of the leading thinkers changing the way we look at economic behavior as part of his series, Making Sense, which airs every Thursday on the NewsHour.
It was Millennium Park, Richard Thaler, an academic revolutionary who thinks his field, economics, has a weirdly distorted view of human behavior, that we're all rational maximizers, mathematical machines who use our unusually big brains to wisely calculate every decision as we strive to get to the top, thus creating perfect markets to make us better off. Yet, says Thaler,
after the 87 crash, when the market fell 20% in a day, and the internet bubble, when the NASDAQ went from 5,000 to 1,400, and then the real estate bubble, which led to a financial crisis from which we're still trying to extricate ourselves, the idea that markets work perfectly is no longer tenable.
Thaler is running his revolution from inside the belly of the beast, the University of Chicago, which boasts 28 Nobel laureates practiced in traditional economics. Collectively, they've created what's known as the Chicago School, predicated on the perfect efficiency of markets in which prices rationally reflect all available information. But at a lunch with star students, Thaler offered his latest favorite example of markets behaving badly. A closed-end stock fund called the Hertzfeld Caribbean Basin Fund.
Ticker symbol, C-U-B-A. Now, needless to say, it cannot and does not invest in Cuba. That's against the law. And there wouldn't be anything to buy anyway. There are no traded securities in Cuba.
Now, typically, the shares of closed-end funds, which simply own a basket of stocks, shouldn't be worth more than the stocks themselves. Otherwise, you could save money by just buying the stocks yourself.
Nevertheless, the day that President Obama made an announcement that relationships with Cuba would be eased, this fund shot to a 70% premium and is now selling at about a 40% premium.
Now, to be fair, the fund does invest in firms likely to benefit from economic development throughout the Caribbean, including Cuba. But that doesn't explain why shares of the fund are now worth a whopping $140 for every $100 worth of actual stocks in the fund.
Cuba. Good. Price goes up. Would you say that's consistent with a rational, efficient market?
Thaler started noticing such market anomalies early in his career as an economist.
The market would go up in January. It would go up on Fridays, down on Mondays. It would go up on the day before holidays. None of this made any sense.
So he began challenging economic orthodoxies. Today, his version of economics, behavioral economics, has finally taken hold. A story that he tells in his new book, Misbehaving. It's a hit even here in Orthodox Chicago, where the book's very price is an example of economic irrationality.
My book is 30% off, and people love deals. They can be driven to purchase things that they don't really want if the deal is good enough.
By contrast, Chicago school economists long argued that if someone chooses to buy Thaler's book, say, or anything else, that's proof enough that they want it at the price being paid. Deal or no deal. All human behavior, says Thaler, was reduced to similar absurdities, usually accompanied by mathematical equations.
Marry the optimal wife. Get divorced when the utility of being married turned negative.
But it was only when Thaler began doing experiments and publishing them that doctrinaire economists, whom he calls econs, began to admit some of the errors of their ways. Take the concept of sunk costs. Time and money already spent. An econ assumes everyone knows when to quit, cut their losses, move on. This group of Cameroonian students at first seemed to get that.
Let's suppose you bought tickets to go to a concert over here at this fancy band show, $40 each. and the group is okay, but then it starts to rain. How long do you think you're going to stick around this concert?
Not much.
But what if the sunk costs suddenly swell?
How many of you would have a different decision about staying or leaving if it was $500 as opposed to $40? Every single one of you.
I have to make my money worth it.
You have to make your money worth it.
Yeah.
And your point here? Well, economists would say, how much you paid for the ticket? Tough luck. If it's $40 or $500, you should just decide whether the music is worth the annoyance of the rain.
Then there's the way most people value their time. As when Riley Gaunt is shopping for a $40 pair of shoes, learns they're on sale for $30.
But it's another store 10-minute drive away.
Okay.
Would you go?
Probably.
Okay.
But what if she's shopping for a $200 dress that she learns another store is selling for $190?
You think you'd go?
No.
But you see the point, right? If 10 minutes is worth $10 to you, then it doesn't matter how you're saving the $10, no?
Yeah, I mean, that makes sense.
Now that you've heard this explanation, would you change your answer?
No, probably not.
So, Charlie.
Her boyfriend, Charlie Ellis, had his own distinctly non-econ approach to personal finance.
Are you pumped about the finals?
I'm so pumped. I'm ready.
We taped this on the eve of the Stanley Cup Finals, eventually won by the Chicago Blackhawks.
Suppose I told you I had two tickets to the first home game, about 10 rows behind the penalty box.
I would be so excited.
Now, let's suppose I gave you those two tickets.
How much would he demand to sell those tickets?
Man, maybe $500 if I could get that.
$500 each?
A pop, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
And how much would he pay if he had to buy the tickets?
Maybe $200.
Okay, so about half.
Yeah.
Now, an econ would say the price to buy or sell should be about the same. But not a human. And not our cameraman. A diehard Blackhawks fan himself who'd heard the entire previous exchange and then gave exactly the same answers.
I would not pay as much as I'm going to sell it for.
And this is after he's heard you do this already. Yeah, you know, teaching the principles doesn't make people do it.
After nearly four decades of trying to prove just how crazy economics can be, Richard Thaler is now running the asylum as president of the American Economic Association. His behavioral economic theories have been put into practice by governments around the world, including ours, in so-called nudge units, based on his previous bestseller. Not bad for a guy who thought he'd never get tenured for such unconventional work. And how does he now feel about being called the inventor of behavioral economics?
One guy can't create a field, but you can get people thinking.
And so he has. This is Paul Solman reporting for the PBS NewsHour from ever more sensible and unorthodox Chicago, Illinois.